Good morning. Like we discussed last night, here we are doing the drive to Manhattan, and it's one of the last days of March, and it's spitting snow. I'm on summer tires, so there's not too much we can do. We can definitely talk about a number of things that I've been itching to tell you all about, but also we can have a nice drive, and it's fun to go into Manhattan. I'm gonna make sure I have my map outlined and ready to go, and let the engine warm up just a little bit before we head out. All right, so once again, this is my 2008 E60 BMW M5. It's a cold start, so if it's anything like me in the morning, it doesn't want to get going until the engine is warmed up. I think we're all kind of like that. And it has this variable tachometer that tells us when the engine is ready to go. Right now it's showing that the red line is 6,250 RPM. When it warms up, it'll be 8,250 RPM, which is remarkable when you consider that this is a 5-liter V10. It can redline that high. It's an incredible piece of engineering, and I think that's reflective of the specialness of this car and its ties to F1 racing, which to me is just as cool as it gets. So I think I'm gonna it's a 37 minute drive. I think I'm going to just drive for a few minutes, probably edit this out. Okay, I'm gonna edit out a good section of this drive that we're on, because it's not really that exciting. And just want to get us to the Hutchinson River Parkway. So I'm just going to drive, shut up, maybe listen to some music. Down the windows a few seconds ago, trying to find a way for us to get some of the sound of the engine in. Thank you. Okay, I think we can start to begin the commentary again. The engine isn't fully warmed up yet. It's redlining now at 7,400 RPM, just shy of 8,250, so we're not quite there. But we're about to hit the highway. There's a good place to do some acceleration. I'm gonna press the M button, which takes the car from 400 horsepower to 507. And I'm turning off the suspension, the tighter suspension setting, because we've got potholes, we're not on a track. I don't think there's any sense in having the tighter suspension on unless you're on a track, because it just makes the ride unpleasant. And I suppose one of the great things about the M5 is that it's a car you can drive with your family comfortably. My M3, you don't want to be a passenger in it unless you're an enthusiast. Otherwise, it's punishing, and why do it unless you like to hang on for dear life? Well, I kind of do, but most people don't. The M5 is a really good balance, except for the wail of the engine. Most people have no idea what it is, or they wouldn't really care, because it's a comfortable German sedan, and that's what most people care about. So it's nice that I can have a little bit of fun at the same time as, people can be comfortable riding around with me. Okay, so there's a really nice, it's such a tight curve that I would say it's a corner, but it's snowy and there are other cars on the road, but there's a really good opportunity for us to, a little acceleration. You kind of actually have to. In some places in New York City, you really do need to have the power. I can't imagine trying to have a Prius in New York, because here we are, we must get up to highway speed immediately. All right, here we go. A WRX. Looks like this WRX is driving really aggressively, which is unfortunate. Anyway, we're at highway speed now, and I believe you want to get that exit, right? Yep. Sixth gear, it has all the power you need from wherever you are in the rev band. Right now we're going about 67 miles an hour, and anyway, we're going about 67 miles an hour, and I'm in sixth gear at 2500 RPM, but now it's going up because we have space. But that snow is disconcerting, so we don't want to mess around with that. Okay, so for New York City Sawmill. Okay. And I hear a lot of buffeting in the back, so I'm going to go ahead and roll up the windows. The car feels tight and competent. I was watching Fifth Gear. And there was an episode where the guy drove from, the north of France all the way down to Monaco. It was a race for time. The fastest car, the most comfortable car you could take to get across that stretch was the M5. So that's what they did. And his whole commentary was, yes, it's fast, and yes, it burns a lot of gas. But it's just better. And yeah, I mean, there's this feeling of competence when you're driving this car. You just, especially when you're on the highway, you just know that you can handle anything that comes at you. And it's a really nice feeling. In most cars, when you're on the highway, you think, gosh, it might be nice to be there right now. I could, save me a few minutes. In this car, you can be quarter mile ahead, and a nanosecond. And I mean, just knowing that you can do that is a lot of fun. But at the same time, I don't really want to, you know, make people hate BMW drivers, because a lot of people hate BMW drivers. So I try not to be one of them. But it's just nice to know that you can move quickly when you're in a pinch. On the highway, I'll say this, it's very, it's almost wasteful to have such a powerful car in the U.S. because it's so much, you know, frowned upon to drive fast. You know, we have speed limits, you know, 55 to 75 miles an hour on the highway. You know, for this car, it's barely even breathing. So it seems like a waste to have that much capacity that's never really used. I mean, the only time that you can really get into it is just a few seconds at a time, because of course it's illegal, and you know, I certainly don't want to get a speeding ticket or anything like that. So, you know, you have to be very careful about how you can use it. I suppose in Germany on the Autobahn, you know, this is like a highway bruiser. And it still can function as a highway bruiser here. I would say really where I fell in love with this car and became, I started to appreciate what it could be, is when I drove it home. I bought the car from my brother, who lives in Georgia, and I flew down and drove back up, actually with my daughter in the back seat, and she was just happy as can be. I was happy as can be because I was driving this car. But this car just gobbles up the miles, and there were, you know, sections where we were in the mountain passes, and all the other cars were huffing and puffing, you know, up the mountain, and this thing just flew past everybody else. And another nice thing about this car is the brakes. I just use them, and they will stop time. I wouldn't say that the M3's brakes are nearly as good. I've heard a lot of complaints about the brakes. It doesn't have the brakes to match the speed, but in the case of the M5, it certainly does. Alright, so we want to get into the left lane, and we're just flying past everybody else like it's nothing. I've got to say, the highway planners, whether it was Robert Moses or what, they did a spectacular job in New York City with doing the highways. They're just beautiful roads. They're a pleasure to drive on. I don't know if they could engineer them again that they... Let's get into a little bit. All right, so the speed limit says 25 here. And we are on snow tires, so it's not like we have the limitless grip that we would in the summer. During summertime, you know, the tires on this car are width of 285. Most cars have about a 195, 205, so you're looking at about 50% more real estate on the tire that's hitting the ground. And with the stickier rubber, of course, that makes all the difference in itself. So this thing will grip the road. You never have to worry about that, which is definitely a thing that you had to worry about. Whoa, BMW driver driving like a jerk. Nice. Totally cut me off, almost hit me. Not paying attention to where he's going, probably. Of course, he's in an X5, but you know, I don't want to generalize. So, I feel like I'm meandering. I'm not making any salient points here. I'm getting a GoPro, and I'm going to start mounting the GoPro on the side of the car. The sound of the engine is glorious, and not that much of it makes it into the cabin, which I think is a shame. But what does come into the cabin is amazing. I would really like to get the GoPro capturing. I just want to see where we are. So Henry Hudson, we don't. Okay, we want to be in the right lane. navigating traffic can be stressful, especially going into a city as big as New York. Especially when there's moisture on the ground, this is an environment that is a little unstable. Anyway, I was talking about the engine note and how very little of it makes it into the cabin. With the GoPro mounted on the side of the car, I think it can be pretty spectacular. If not, then we can mount it on the back of the car and just have the camera pointed at the pipes, because it does sound incredible at the back of the car. And part of the reason for me wanting to do these videos is to capture these cars. I can't drive them as much as I want to. Wish this guy would move over so I can pass him. Hit on this point before with the M3, that one of the biggest frustrations that you encounter when you finally get your dream car is that you very rarely get to drive it the way it was engineered to be driven. It's kind of sad. I'm in the left lane on the highway, I'm going 52 miles an hour. In town, you know, I'm going 25 miles an hour. Sometimes, you know, it's frustrating because the people in front aren't very aware. There are a lot of really bad drivers out there. Some people just drive slow. But yeah, it can be frustrating because, you know, here this car has all of this potential and I'm barely able to explore it. You know, the TAC, as much as we like to talk about screaming engines and high RPM power, reality is it's pretty rare that I get it past 4,000 RPM. I mean, whenever I can get it up to 5,000 RPM, but in order to go beyond that, you need a lot of space. Okay, so now we are crossing into Manhattan. Beautiful stretch right here. It's one of the rare opportunities you have to see that Manhattan was once a forested island. It, you know, it hasn't always been covered in concrete. Okay, so we're going through the toll booth. Slamming on the brakes. Okay, let's see if we can get it. $6,500. Okay, but now we're just flying past traffic, and I just barely tapped the brakes, and I'm back to a somewhat acceptable rate of speed. And so this is another thing that I kind of like about the M5. It gets terrible gas mileage, but right now, I'm in neutral. Once you get up to a certain speed, you just sort of set it, and it cruises. Okay, now I'm putting it into gear, but I don't actually have to. In fact, all right, we can coast for a little bit. you know, it's got all of this muscle and everything, but at the same time, it doesn't need to be that way all the time. And it's not like it's upset. The car's not upset when it's not being, you know, driven like it's stolen. But that's certainly, whenever you're in a hurry, this is a great car to be in. Doesn't happen very often that, you know, you have to call out all the stops and, you know, drive a little bit more aggressively than you would otherwise, but sometimes you have to be somewhere and it is what it is. Doesn't happen very often. But when that happens, this is a great car to be in. The harder you push it, the more it rewards you. It changes personalities. I mean, this is very much a Jekyll and Hyde kind of car. And I've heard that from a lot of people. I've, of course, you know, watched a bunch of videos of other people talking about the car. And then, of course, I've read everything I can get my hands on about the car. It's perfectly content to just drive around and serve the function of, you know, the equivalent German V8 sedan. But then you press this button and it switches personalities and it just becomes wild. It's so cool. And of course there's the sound of the engine, which is not like a V8. The extra two cylinders definitely changes the feel of the car. So by the way, we are well into Manhattan now. We're going down the Hudson Parkway, which will become West Side Drive. It is snowing. I assume that the roads are pretty slick right now, so definitely want to take it easy. Always fun to drive down here. Let's see, and I want to turn off at potholes. 54th Street. Oh, more potholes. So these tires to replace, I have not replaced them yet, but I assume they're going to be, my M3s are $350 each, and that's coming off of Tire Rack where they're discounted. They're going to be expensive. It's interesting that cars have now started to have significantly beefier tires than when I was a kid. I don't think it's just because the cars are bigger and because they have more power. I think that they really do give the driver a sense of more substantial road holding. One of the cars that my wife had was a Nissan Altima, and it wasn't a very special car. It was a 2.5-liter four-cylinder, certainly wasn't powerful, it had 170 horsepower. But to drive it on the highway was very confidence-inspiring. It didn't have a whole lot of acceleration, but it had nice grip and nice road holding. You drive it and feel confident that you are in good hands. And that extra little, you know, bit of width on the tire makes a lot of difference there. But with a 285 width, this thing is like glue on the road. Whenever I'm encountered with enthusiasts, I guess I should talk about, you know, some of the things that more than likely those of you watching the video are going to be focused on. It's the performance aspects. So yes, it has this F1 derived 5-liter V10 engine, the S85, just a glorious piece of engineering, no compromises. In town, the thing gets about 8 miles per gallon. On the highway, if you're feather footing it, it gets about 20 miles per gallon. And yet the car was created with this philosophy. I think they call it efficient dynamics, something like that. So this is as efficient as they could possibly get it to be. But the way that most of us think of efficiency is fuel economy. In this case, it's extracting as much power from that 5-liter engine block as they could. which I think is pretty cool. I think it's it changes the dynamic of the car. It makes it something that's extreme. It's just something I have to respect a lot. Okay, so another topic that I should talk about a little bit is winter. So this is one of the last days of the month of March. We are into spring now, although there's very little evidence of it. Right now it's 35 degrees and it's snowing. doesn't feel like spring to me. This car is next to useless on snow. Not that I really want to drive it on the snow anyway, but, and I'm lucky that I'm in a position to not really have to drive that much. We live near a train station and I work from home most days, so I don't really need to leave in the car too often. Certainly when there's snow and ice on the ground, you would think that with a manual transmission it wouldn't be that bad, but one of the aspects of the E60 M5 manual transmission, which is pretty rare, I've read that there are about 1 in 10. You can't turn off the traction control. And in the snow and ice, you're gonna slide. So what that actually translates into is that if you're in a position where you can't get the wheels to spin, the car doesn't move. My daughters and I went to pick up my wife one night when we had gotten, over the course of the day, you know, something like 6 inches of snow. It was a lot of snow. I'm going to get into a different lane here. Oh, actually, I'm okay. No, let's stay where we are. Anyway, my daughters and I had gone to pick up my wife at the train station, which is about 8/10 of a mile from our house. And I spun out when I was going down a hill, going to pick her up, and that was scary. Somehow, I did not manage to damage the car. But when we were coming back, we had to go uphill, and it was just a very slight hill that we were going up, but it was enough that the tires began to spin, and so the car was basically inching along at about 2 to 3 miles an hour. It took us about, you know, 30, 35 minutes to get us all home. Would have been quicker if we had walked. Much quicker, actually. So that was a scary situation, and you know, the car, you know, came out of it just fine, but it's certainly, you know, don't fool yourself if you think that you can live in an area where there's a lot of snow and be able to make this truly a daily driver. One of the guys I've met on Instagram, who's also a BMW M enthusiast, he has an E46 M3. And he was saying that winter tires truly do make all the difference. But I'm sure, you know, that's like $1,500. You have to get wheels. You know, that's, I actually don't know how much that would cost. It's a lot more than I'm willing to pay, at least today. So I would rather just not drive it. I'd rather not get the salt on the paint and on the exhaust system and all of that. So, anyway, I don't think there's going to be too much more that we can add to this. I am almost at my destination. I'm on the West Side Highway at 54th Street. Let's hope this video turns out to be useful. Okay, thanks for watching.